Center for Urban Development Studies as a trainer and capacity building facilitator. He is also associated with 11 different states, including Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Orissa, Kerala, Delhi, Assam, Punjab, Jharkhand, and Uttar Pradesh in varied projects of heritage, human settlements, infrastructure planning and development. He is presently visiting faculty in architecture and engineering colleges, an empaneled architect in central government and state government projects. He is an alumni of SPA New Delhi in architectural conservation and has other additional qualifications of PG diploma from various universities, including Telugu University and Osmania University. He has professional associations and memberships with AIIA as life member with INTAC and ICOMAS, and also a member of National Scientific Committee of Cultural Landscapes with ICOMAS India. He has international membership with Asian Cultural Landscape Association, Korea. He is also a member with International Institute for Conservation since 2 years. We are highly elated in welcoming you, sir. Thank you for coming here, and over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Meenakshi. Could you all hear my voice?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you so much. Thank you for this nice opportunity to interact with all of you, and especially students in this. So I'm going to start my presentation, and I will share the screen.
Make it full screen, sir. And then start.
So could you see the full screen, sir?
Not full screen, sir. You have to full screen and then share. Just press F5. Sir, just now put F5. Make the PD share the screen.
No.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Fine, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much. And so today's presentation is on urban design strategies, in which I will be covering on urban conservation. There is the images what you are seeing, they are connected to various places, locations, contexts. So it is not just only urban conservation, but the concept of urban conservation, how it has come about in India, and what it is as a practice, and what it is as a theory, and what is required to be understood as the concept of urban conservation. So for this, we need a little bit of theoretical understanding and also contextual understanding of these places, locations, regions, areas. If you see the history, I'm not going to take much on the theoretical aspects, but I will be covering a lot of case studies. Examples of case studies. What I am showing here is three images. One is the Gopuram, and another one is a tribal context artifact, and an archaeological site. So what conforms to urban conservation, or if we want to understand history of conservation, for what purpose? It is for regenerating, conserving, restoring, reusing. When we talk about natural resources, we talk about conserving the natural resource. So we need to understand there is a human created wealth across the world in terms of material culture, materials, objects, buildings, architecture, art, artifacts, so much termed as cultural resource. So we have natural resource and cultural resource. So culture, identity and history are the determining terms for conservation. And when we say there are forms and levels of conservation, what form are we doing? Are we restoring something? Are we regenerating something? Are we reviving something? And we also use loosely repairing something, repairing, repair of a building, repair. Like regeneration, restoration, conservation. These are forms and levels. Levels is, are we talking about an object, artifact, a painting, or a building, or area? So the conservation of an object in a museum, conservation of building, of a building at a location, and conservation of an area, and conservation of natural resources like water bodies, forests, villages. So how do we know that this is required to be conserved? We know we have understanding from the oral traditions, practicing traditions, traditional texts and literature. There are various sources of association with place, with cultural resources. It can be history, it can be about people, it can be about objects, it can be about paintings. So there are traditions, traditional way of reviving, restoring, continuing. So it can be for the purpose of reviving, restoring, or continuing the tradition. And in India, through archaeology and cultural history, the very idea of conservation has started, including architectural, technological, and scientific and knowledge about history. Just in the previous presentation, what was mentioned as master planning knowledge is influencing our way of urbanism, Indian urbanism. My previous speaker was talking about it. So education and initiatives in education in the society overall influenced the key component. So what we are actually listening to now and what we have listened just now, so that is the key component to understand the way we want to restore something, revive something. So in India, with the entry of, with the establishment of organization like Royal Asiatic Society, and with the researchers on historical and traditional buildings like, for example, temple architecture by Ram Raj in 1834, and history of architecture by James Ferguson, and establishment of Archaeological Survey of India in 1870, and the formation of Geographical Survey of India, Biological Survey of India, with the interest in something in India and Indian culture, also caused interest in protecting and preserving towards future and understanding. The very purpose was to understand, but it continued towards conserving and protecting and maintaining for future. Similarly, there were administrative reforms during British the colonial regime, that is East India Company, town administration and formation of municipal administration, and formation of engineering and survey departments within East India Company for the construction of new buildings and any building. And parallel to that, across India, there were other influencing factors like princely states, like in the case of Hyderabad, we have Nizam ruling and Arcot region and Mysore region, like that Awadh region. There were princely states which were determining the idea of protecting the culture towards future. And Indian railways, industrial revolution, and 1904 Ancient Monuments Act, they played major role. It has played major role in understanding and protecting the future. So it was, whether it is a small location, place or building, everything was covered under Ancient Monuments Act. And there were guidelines how to conserve these monuments. So they were treated as individual single buildings rather than group of buildings and areas. And the world wars in between during this time also had influenced the understanding and the purpose of, because the, during the wars, if you see, most of the culture is demolished or sometimes destructed. And we are witnessing even in the recent times where in the Central Europe and other regions, Middle East and such regions, there are, due to wars, destruction happening to cultural resource. So the wars also had a tremendous influence on the overall performance of protecting cultural resources. And independence, in fact, to India has created a different vision, with the Constitution of India defining a role for protecting our culture and the uniqueness of our culture, the diversity, protecting the diversity and unity in diversity, the very nature of Indian places, Indian culture, has given certain directions, though the details could be seen in the actual practices and methods. And in such a way, after independence, 1904 Ancient Monuments Act underwent a revision in 1958. And apart from that, we have protected monuments under state and central governments, and now local governments, urban or rural, panchayat, gram panchayat government, or urban local bodies. They have the power and methods to protect and manage these resources. So for all this, you need identification of monuments and identification of areas, places to be protected. But how do we protect? We are going to see with some of the case studies. And if you see the built heritage in India, across India, as I mentioned just now, it is rich and diverse cultural heritage. But reading history with colonial perspective has resulted in Western system of cultural resource management. Just now, the previous speaker also has mentioned that mixed land use and the mixed Rubik system, that itself is the very nature of Indian functioning of cities, places and locations. So that has been emphasized in the colonial history, colonial way of the British system or the Western system of planning and the resource management, be it natural resources and cultural resources, has resulted in the similar methods of protection. And always, if we look at the planning, it is always shown as walled city or inner city. Old areas, if you see, they are always referred as inner city, walled city. And it is seen as some kind of a dot or some area rather than going into the details. But with the advent of this new studies happening in be it urban design, be it in architecture or archaeology and architectural conservation. Now the there is as the knowledge influences the method of work. So the knowledge is emphasizing on looking at the details of these walled cities, inner cities and inner places. As we see, what I'm going to cover here, I'm going to cover all these topics relating to as part of the idea on urban conservation. If you look at, just read the, only the blue points, when we say urban conservation, it could be a building within a campus, a building in a location, a building in an area. So place, so the place making gives an identity. So that is required to be conserved, a precinct, zone, a region, landscape, historic urban landscape. All these contribute to the definition of urban conservation. The only thing is whether we are referring in a within a city context or a campus, it differs. So conservation, as it started from museum to monument to now the there are when you look at the building level, because whatever the what is the style of construction that happens in a particular given time, the tradition or the technology that is available. But the buildings constructed in the olden times, the technology doesn't exist right now. The craftspersons, they don't continue. So that has to be revived. So there is a need to even understand the craft level work when it comes to conservation in detail at the building level. But there are very various methods. How do we do it? By listing, by documenting, by understanding the character, by defining the character. So I'm going to talk about be it the building level or the various locations across India where I had direct experience to define whether it is a building, area, place, precinct, but which leads to understanding of broad urban conservation understanding. So these are some of the presentations relating to building level. When we see a building level, I am quoting some five examples here, Victoria Public Hall, Chennai. So when we are looking at building level, we look at the problems relating to the building. Problems relating to the building are identified and they are rectified within the site. If you look at the State Center Library in Hyderabad, as you would see, the problems faced by this 80 years old building is indicated and solutions are given as a comprehensive whole of the building. So it is addressing, protecting and restoring the building within a campus and site. The kind of observations, the kind of information that we collect is pertaining to the building. Like Mozam Jahi Market. See, this is a place and the moment you reach this location, you feel like you are at a location, not at a building. So the whole area has got the name of the building name as a location name. So how that gets defined? Because of its architecture, because of its volume that is present within the whole site. So, but this is also the build, but the actual ground level, the building level work is handled so that the place level identity is maintained in this case. Like another one, Nizamiya Hospital, just opposite Charminar, you would have this structure which is about 85 years old construction. The problems of it identified. Once restored, it would give the meaning to the entire campus. So that is the building level observation. And similarly, this Usmania General Hospital was a major construction happening along the Musi River in Hyderabad. So this is the artistic, so if you look at this picture itself, it is not just a building, it is the, it is a place in front of the river, which is about 95 years old right now. So this requires a different level of approach, and it's not just only the building level, but the campus level understanding to maintain the visibility and understanding of the whole site. So we need to collect information, and the old maps are required to be collected, and we need to show the transformations and morphological changes happening within the site and understand, and also the contemporary maps would give information and site level information, how this has undergone change. This is the heritage building, and these are the new additions that took place within the campus. And all these red colored things are planned to be demolished. Now there is a separate plan to emphasize the heritage visibility of the site. A new building is proposed on the rear side without dominating the structure, and so that the heritage is visible and it is not distracting view from the main roadside. So the building level needs a different type of approach, whereas area level, if you see, I'm going to demonstrate with another presentation, which is at the area level. If you look at this street, this area, I'm talking about Charminar area, the iconic location within Hyderabad, the inner city area. If you look at the overall activities taken up in this area, it is connected to urban design, it is connected to urban conservation, it is connected to building level conservation, and also traffic management, because they don't exist in isolation. When we talk about building level, only building is conserved, but it is impacted because of the road, because of the traffic, because of what is available in the surroundings. So Charminar at the center, and there is a traffic plan that is planned along with the, so that means when we talk about building, you address only the building. When we say area, not just only Charminar area, but the entire 5 kilometer range from Charminar as a whole old walled city, the fortified city that was established as a city plan. See the gridiron layout with the Charbagh garden ideas incorporated in the city layout. So there is one key street that was identified, and within that the pockets were identified. So this is how we look at and identifying the character generating locations and regions. Charminar is identified, and the front market, Patragati market, is identified, and in front of that, and just beside Musi River, the major junction, traffic junction. So it is not just only the character generating historical buildings, but also connected face and connected networks also form part of the overall work that is required to be handled. And while doing it, you also need to talk about the activities that happen, and how do we use the spaces once we redesign those roads, or once we reorganize those shops, once we reorganize and rationalize the infrastructure, road infrastructure, lighting infrastructure that is available. So the kind of drawings that we prepare, it is one of the 1 kilometer stretch, kind of activities in Madina Street, And it also requires talking about organizing the activities. So without what we say as informal can be formalized by licensing. And we need to be aware of the policies that exist to rationalize these activities. Because the moment we say, though it is a very temporary market, that also influences the architectural and visual and physical appearance of the location and the character of the location and place, which are required to be addressed and cannot be ignored and cannot be just treated as something to be taken out from the location. So there are various type of hawkers and the existing road characteristics and dimensions are required to be documented and seen and verified with the design proposals. So this is the one of the proposal and we preferred the visual scape understanding method as a proposal for maintaining the skyline. And so as you see, the many cables and many obstructing things are visible. The parking is rationalized, the traffic is rerouted, and the signage is rationalized, and a new footpath and things are planned along the heritage buildings. So there are many proposals prepared, and when you are doing a public proposal like this, you need to have various ideas and consult local people, consult. It is not an urban case, unlike a building proposal. Building proposal can be completely technical work. This urban conservation activity is also technical work, but it requires a lot of public consultation, stakeholder consultation, in order to inform and undertake an informed activity and involved conservation activity within the site. So the traffic is required to be studied. Traffic pattern has been studied, and the various roads have been studied. And I'm just taking off some of the slides. And this is Patrakatti. This is the existing scenario, and this is the future proposal with the changed so that heritage is visible, character is visible. So what is the change from this to this? When you have the old one, the current misuse and overuse of the space, you are not able to appreciate and see the character and the idea and identity of the place. Whereas when you do this, you will be able to appreciate and see and relate and identify the location. So consolidating these informal activities so that they are scattered and they can be organized at different places, which are lying at different places. One of them is shifted and moved to a different location. So across the streets, across the buildings is required to be intervened. So the character of the place is made visible. All is planned to be made underground cables, and the rationalization has been done, and there is a fountain opposite before reaching Charminar named Gulzar House. That is also rationalized, and traffic activity. So when you're talking about urban conservation, the main intervention could be on the road. Main intervention could be on the network, on the infrastructure. It need not be. So when you segregate what is required to be conserved in the building, what is required. You are not actually conserving anything, but the idea is being conserved when you are touching infrastructure, networks, and other related connections. And you also need to present for the visitors. Visitors is not just only tourism. When you are talking about the daily visitors, and also the heritage is celebrated, heritage is viewed apart from making it visible. So even in the night, because the night market is also very much vibrant in the case of Hyderabad, that is made to highlight and make the identity visible with the help of lighting. And uniform, though it all started with in the year 2000 with B.V. Doshi, Vastu Shilpa consultants. Later, the detailing had been worked out by local consultants like me and other few other consultants, where we rationalized and worked on ground to work out further details as outlined during the year 2000 by Vastu Shilpa consultants. Some of the sign boards and there are services, and we took examples from Connaught Place, where such type of efforts were taken up during Commonwealth Games during 2008, 2009, 2010. Because the project went on till 2015, even some portions of it are still happening. That means about 20 years ago it all started, but still it is continuing with small works still pending. So the parallel cases have been studied before undertaking the work, during the work in Connaught Place, and after the work in Connaught Circus in Connaught Place. And if you look at the overall say layout in the thing, you have this road network being concentrated upon for the purpose of identity making within the area. So many streets were studied, and like this carriageway, many demolitions, new buildings which are distracting and which are not actually giving any character to the whole site have been rationalized, and they have also been studied. This is all part of urban conservation activity, though you don't actually do any conservation, direct conservation activity. It leads to establishing the clear visibility of identity giving aspects of the city, or the character generating the resource, cultural resource of the city will be visible with the activity taken up. So the rationalization of transport network shown here. Charminar as a precinct had been handled. See the network, it is not geometrical, and there are a lot of changes you would see, and a lot of modifications since the inception of the town. And you would see a disorganized geometry around Charminar. So, but that is required to be rationalized and again made to be organized. So the work done, various patterns to make the structure visible, the rules defining the monument, like Archaeological Survey of India has a specific, being the owner of Charminar, has certain definitions, and city administration, which is looking at urban conservation, is looking at other encroachments and other obstructions within the city. So these are required to be handled together in order to define the achievements required, objectives to be achieved within the project. So the though the pattern is completely unorganized, to make it organized, the pathway pattern and things are defined within the visible area. As you see, the pattern detailing has been done. So when it comes to the detailing, it may be just only simple curb level detail or the lighting post detail and seating detail and tree grade detail, and also it amounts to showing some of the examples how you can make some kiosks or carts, push carts as a model to reflect the character even in their such type of structures. So like that, we have so many aspects to urban conservation of an area, and this demands the not just only at the end we are intervening in the roads, but you have the architecture and character defining components to be documented to define what is the character of a location. So the entire 1 kilometer stretch of the buildings and also the all locations of conservation precincts and areas have been documented in detail for undertaking this work. And this all it all started not just with the area. So no one thought about to think about 5 kilometer range around Char Minar. It all started with when a large chunk of plaster from Char Minar fell off, and they said the traffic vibrations are causing damage to iconic building of Hyderabad. So it all started with that, and it resulted in urban conservation of addressing about 12 kilometer road, 5 kilometer range around Char Minar, and about 70-80 buildings of heritage buildings, and 20 pockets, urban pockets within Char Minar. It is not just only traffic or building. Also the visitors, the tourism also has been addressed by devising these 20 pockets as a tourism visit spots by introducing heritage walks. Some 8 heritage walks were introduced during the year 2000 by Vastu Shilpa consultants. So it, as you would see, a large chunk of plaster falling off from Char Minar has resulted in the entire area of work resulting in so many aspects of urban inner area. It is not just a single building. It has generated so much of work. And similarly, I am coming to another location, Tirupati Eco City project. This is I am talking about 2005. Temple towns in South India. You are all familiar. We are all from South India, and temple architecture is not just in the temple. Temple is the entire context. The whole Tirupati started with this Govindarajaswamy temple as a starting point in 12th century, in 11th and 12th century, when Ramanuja established his matha near Govindarajaswamy temple, and subsequently it had grown into a city. And later Tirumala, which developed into a large complex structures during Vijayanagara period. And subsequently we have expansion of many temple complexes across South India with a lot of context and character being added because of social, and cultural activities connected within the place. So this also requires identifying and mapping such spots. It cannot be seen in isolation. It has to be seen as a connected things to the overall character generating component. That is what had been studied under this Tirupati Ecocity project. So I'm coming to another place, calling it as urban conservation, but if you see for developing heritage tourism, for adventure tourism, the location, as you would see, it's 300 feet above the river, Penna River, the Gandikota, which is forming a gorge with the natural surroundings and Grand Canyon of India, it is said, with the kind of rock formations. You have a historical setting just adjacent to the river, above 320 feet. And with a small settlement just beside, all these are required to be looked at to generate, because tourism cannot be just generated by providing some accommodation or some food court. But there, it is connected with how you are generating and connecting the heritage resource. So that has been studied in while doing, while undertaking this kind of work. And the entire area of Gandikota had been studied, identifying the locations and connecting and generating some kind of a trekking, because there are hill and rock formations which are around the structure, and all these are studied and identified and mapped. So we don't have the direct maps available for this, and surveyed land of 3 kilometers was not available. So how did we start from by expanding? This was in 2002 and 2003. We did 2004. We completed and using only Survey of India map. So that was enlarged and ground verified and completed and mapped. Today we have a lot of resources through Google Maps and Google Contour Survey. Everything is available today. So the components were identified and a plan was prepared. And I presented one more example along with the buildings. If you remember in the previous slides, there is Mazamjahi Market. As I said, the building level generating a meaning of a precinct. It is a building, but it is generating a meaning of an area, precinct, and location. So because of the form and volume it is giving to the site and outside, it is giving the entire character to the street and location and place. As you would see in the aerial picture of this, which is no more visible like this because of the flyover constructed just adjacent to these structures right now. So there is a flyover, there is actually metro train passes through this area and it goes like this completely. So no one standing here, as the human understanding of the places is completely disturbed now. So we have lost the overall idea of city, the human centric. Even in the previous presentation, the human centric adjustment within the places is the key for maintaining Indian urbanism or Indian methods of maintaining these identities and locations of these places. So the actual work is, once the building is conserved, it would give the better place to be used, and also will be useful and structurally strong and strengthened, and it will live for another similar number of years but it presents the character. But if you are not addressing the actual connected networks, the way we constructed the metro train way right now, so it has disturbed irrespective of whether you conserve a building or not. You are not really conserving the area, you are conserving a building and like an artifact. So it is not a comprehensive approach. It is not a, when you are look at campuses and locations like this. I will give quickly show one more thing, which is a building, but is seen as a location. In Hyderabad, this is Mehboob Chowk Market, which is with now Murgi Chowk. It is called Murgi Market, chicken market. It is the poultry and market. Completely has this sheet roofing, like industrial sheet roofing. So there is, if you look at the plan within the city, it is 1.5 kilometers from Charminar, and this is the market. Yellow line is the market, and it defines the precinct. It establishes the meaning of a precinct. So in order to understand that, one has to look at this as a overall area. Though there are buildings and individual buildings, it has to be seen as a overall area, and one has to study the surrounding land use, surrounding building use, but it has to be comprehensively viewed. It cannot be dealt in isolation. It has to be. So the new proposals aimed at retaining the overall structure, maintaining the but adding an additional floor along with maintaining, because this is a load-bearing structure, so the additional floor had been proposed and ideas have been given for this structure. So the detailed building level conservation is also addressed, new study has been conducted, and new proposal with two-storied structure maintaining the character had been proposed for the overall idea retaining aspect of the structure. Another structure just adjacent to the Mehboob Chowk, the one what we had seen just now. So there are cases like in a within the location, doing a single building can enhance the character of the street. So a old house was, a hut was there, and that was demolished and constructed using the traditional construction of the street. This house was constructed. This is a modern structure, but completely constructed using the old construction principles of the street. So the entire street had been documented, and this building had been constructed. And so this is giving the presence as part of the village, rather than dominating and coming out differently from a location. And there are cases like this monument. How a monument can play a role of a context, a place. So it is a World Heritage Site. So site is not just a single building. It is connected with so many other structures around. It cannot be understood if it is protected as a single building. So when we are talking about tourism, it cannot be addressed as a single building. What it used to have a connection with the whole surroundings and location is required to be maintained. So in order to do that, it cannot be just a building conservation. It has to be seen as a location and place rather than a single building. And I'm going to show another one where we did in 2013, where it's a mix of urban design and conservation. The idea of a town was to be developed. So developing, because there was no character for the roads leading towards Golden Temple and location, to develop a form for the street identifiable with the city of Amritsar and Sikh culture was made. So a proposal was prepared and we studied the Connaught Circus, Dadabhai Nauroji Road and Horniman Circle, MG Road Lucknow, Bapu Market Jaipur, Atharkatti Hyderabad, where such type of initiatives were taken up. So one has to look at the context, similar context or different context, how these are, there is no standard single principle, and the principle is generated from the context and location. So that is the very understanding of urban conservation or area conservation need to be. So every place demands a different approach. So the various places of these locations have been studied. Horniman Circle, how they modified Lucknow, how it was there and how it was modified later by making uniform signboards. Bazaar Street in Jaipur, how they maintained the whole thing. Patargatti, how it was there and how it was modified later by uniform signboards and things. The roads leading to Golden Temple, Harmandir Sahib have been studied. So this was required to be presented as a heritage street. Not the entire pasting of architecture, but such type of approach had been attempted. By studying, and this is the existing thing, and this is how they have been modified. And if you look at the existing context and the architecture components have been studied and they have been made. So the benefits of facade improvement have been shown there. And we did a similar project in Jharkhand, where the objective was similar, but it required the work around a traditional temple, Baba Baijanath temple, which was the traditional temple in Jharkhand, where people used to visit for pilgrimage purpose. So that is also not addressed just as a single place, but the context around it had been studied by studying the architecture within the place available. And the overall objective in this had been kept to develop a form for the street identifiable. So we're talking about identity and identifiable with the city of Devghar and its culture. So Amritsar of the this is the current status. This is a developed one. This is the real pictures from the site, how it used to look like before and how it is modified later, how it used to look like before and how it is modified later, the same context modified, and it is from the real site. These are not photoshopped images or anything. These are from the real site, how that is generating some kind of a character for the whole site. So the all the underground cabling had been taken up, and some of the unplastered surfaces have been plastered, and the simple components have been added. That is how things get defined. Parking complex, multi-story, the four-storied parking complex had been modified as an approach to give a character. It was looking, and this is how it is made. These are the real pictures. And similarly, the study had been undertaken in Baba Baidyanath, Jharkhand. As you would see, the roads and networks, these have been studied, architecture had been studied. Quite the detailed study of the area and cross sections across the streets to define, to get a character and to define these. So without demolitions, how character could be brought in for the same thing by giving and without damaging much, without adding much to the whole street. Things have been defined to give a character for this location. Another location with another two more locations, I will be concluding my presentation. This is another in Telangana, where just a simple circle, but how there is no defining character. People relate as tower chowk, tower circle. And so how character could be given by relating only to this central structure. The central structure is taken, and the surrounding traffic and road widths have been studied. The problems have been studied, parking related issues have been studied, infrastructure related issues have been studied in the area. And during the year, throughout the year, how the same location gets used. So they also have been rationalized, and restrictions have been put, and how this could be utilized more appropriately without damaging the entire location. So the they have been rationalized, and traffic rerouting had been suggested, one-way traffic had been suggested, and parking sites have been identified. Parking is rationalized, and the parking studies also have been conducted. So the main aim was giving a character to the maintaining a character and bringing the form to the site. But the studies required are and the actual work that is required to be taken up is connected to many other aspects relating to road, network, traffic, and people, parking, and such aspects. So they have been studied, and the colors have been studied, suggested for the buildings to make. So not much of the architecture has been changed in these, just only the uneven and disorganized architecture is just maintained by bringing change in color. It was planned to bring some kind of a form to the location. This is a competition where in future Connaught Place, how this is going to be used without losing the character. So we were the winners in this competition, Connaught Place. I just wanted to share and how sustainability and maintaining the character and without losing the without compromising the technological knowledge and technology that is available in future, without compromising on that, how one can maintain the character and even enhance the character that is present in the place had been attempted. So sustainable development is the main plan that is given. I will not go into this detail of, I will just quickly run through the presentation where we did one Meghalaya urban design project where the character of the tribal culture had been kept in mind in generating the architectural character for a junction within the site. So the without compromising the tribal cultural resource available, this had been planned, and this was a competition project. We were adjudged as in third place as competition participants. another one, Kashmir, where a campus level plan had been done for a silk factory. This is the campus level. Existing godowns of 1920s old Kashmir silk factory. So Kashmir is known for silk formation and silk fabric, and so all these godowns and the entire factory site is transformed into a cultural center. We took some kind of, so conservation of a campus, conservation at the precinct level. We are conserving the building, structurally strengthening the buildings, at the same time reuse and adaptive reuse of a campus without losing the character that is required to be maintained within the site. So that is how we had been attempted in a campus design level work. I mean, sometimes we need to think about larger regions. It need not be urban, it can be rural, it can be an environment altogether. Where I'm talking about a largest river island in Assam, Majuli, the river island of Majuli cultural landscape. So that means the whole river island is presenting the meaning of cultural landscape. Why it is a cultural landscape? Because there are some religious institutions within the site, and those religious institutions are because of the Brahmaputra River that is formed, and they connect everything, the whole culture, agriculture, life cycle, everyday cycle, annual cycle is connected with the wetlands that are present within the site. So the water, the settlement pattern, everything is connected, and we prepared a nomination dossier for this, to present this as a World Heritage Site. It was inscribed as a tentative list, and it is yet to be recognized as a final site, World Heritage Site. So the detailed survey of about 1,000 square kilometer area had been attempted. The red spots you would see are the settlements and present within the island. The entire island is not the settlement. So the, in this case, the meaning of urban conservation completely changes. It cannot be viewed as only a single site. These are the some of the sites, and you have so many wetlands present within the area. And it can also be related as an archaeological park. Urban conservation also can be related as landscape, historic villages conservation, Hampi World Heritage Area. It is about 25 square kilometers area, and now we have about 100 square kilometer area having so many villages around Hampi. So Hampi, though it is protected as 64 or 67 monuments under Archaeological Survey of India, it has so many living villages. So it can, now it is declared as a Hampi World Heritage Management Authority area. So the area has archaeological parks, monuments, living villages, and everything connected to current tourism, and so many visitors. Similarly, the idea of towns and cities. If you see the old town patterns in Telangana, one Kakatiya Fort Warangal, if you see the old fort has a road like this and going like a swastika pattern. It is going like a swastika. Swastika pattern. What is defined in our ancient texts as swastika towns is part of this layout. So what is required to be conserved in this case of archaeological sites, cities, where many locations are encroached upon. They are not just single locations. There are many parts of it are encroached upon. So it requires a altogether different approach. How do we protect and preserve? It is not a single monument or building. So the idea of urban conservation cannot be limited to just only precinct and area. These are all some of the ideas that came up across India, specific to the context, rather than as a overall principle applicable for entire Indian context or entire places. One has to look at these and look from the various organizations and that are working in this, like Archaeological Survey of India, local government, INTAC, and there are also city level NGOs which all of you must be aware of, be it in Kolkata, New Delhi, Chennai, Mumbai, Hyderabad. There are architecture colleges. As I mentioned in the beginning itself, that the knowledge defines the current knowledge or the type of knowledge with which we acquire understanding of urbanism or urban conservation or urban design makes a difference. The kind of initiatives being taken up by architecture colleges and studies being conducted by architecture colleges is also changing the perspective and vision towards understanding and making of these places. And geography and planning institutes also are encouraging now interdisciplinary studies, not just only specific to architecture, specific to geography, specific to planning, but people are encouraging interdiscipline. Geographer is looking at architecture, architect is looking at geographer, and history and culture, all these are looking at various disciplines before intervening. So what is important is documenting the context or area is most important, and we need to understand the what is the right meaning of it. It is not just only what is given by the contemporary interpretation, but what is the meaning of it? What is the pattern that we see? What is the geometry? And what is the theory behind the construction and making of that identity of a particular place? And it has to be viewed from human, anthropological, society, history, and geographical perspective. And one cannot be just keep on living with the old literature that is already available with us, like Western knowledge system, that is required to be challenged, and one can get the understanding if it touches the ground. So the actual meaning and is available directly in the context. So the studying Indian context with contextual construction knowledge systems will help in regenerating and bringing a new value for the future space that can, that if at all we want to give for the past places that we have. So with this, I conclude my presentation. I thank the organizers for giving this opportunity.
Thank you, sir, for giving us such a fascinating and insightful presentation to all of us.
Yeah.
So I request participants to raise your hand, or click on the raise your hand option to ask any question to the presenter. I think we have a question from Arun Prakash. So you can unmute yourself to ask your question.
Sir, first of all, we are really thankful for your great presentation. It is touching from the micro level to macro level, like from the micro level, Hampi, Anagund, house, the urban conservation, like Gandhikota heritage, this one town actually. So up to there, we are having a insight on it. It will be a great presentation actually, sir. It is really overwhelming. Actually, I am having two questions from my side. The question one is, the right now what we are facing, that smart cities, is that adhere with our conservative urbanism taken place on that actually, that we have to, one is, yeah, my question. Another also, can I just ask now, sir? Like,
yes, please.
Another one is, the hidden things like our own archaeological sites, preservatives, how these things will be by this point of time, how we can focus on how we can carry forward our things to our future generation. Those things we have to have some sight on it, sir.
Yeah,
thank
sure.
You.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, sure. First question, yes, smart cities, there is an inclusion of idea of conservation, but at the ground level, one has to undertake detailed study relating to documentation. One has to document not from the secondary sources or already published and old information. Though we need to search that information, one has to look at the ground and see whether people are relating to that identity and culture within the place. People may have already dissociated themselves in such in many locations with the because of the technology overriding our entire work, our entire understanding, our entire day-to-day life. So one has to verify, but the idea of smart cities certainly is talking about sustainability and future of such culturally significant places. It is addressing, but the details, as I said, one has to, the purpose, the methodology should be, we should document and understand from the direct context. Direct context is including people, current people, current visitors, current users of the place. That gives us strength. And coming to second question, yes, it can be addressed. Even that is also almost similar to the first question, not on smart cities, but in order to get the clue for understanding and for undertaking any study, has to be comprehensive and area specific. It cannot be, though we are talking about single building, we need to have the scope of your work doesn't define. Just simple example I will give you. For example, if any person coming for the repair of a drainage network, he comes and repairs that and leaves. That doesn't have anything to do with the entire context at the physical level, but it has connection to the quality of life that is connected with the immediate surroundings and immediate users. So it has to be viewed and tested with the, one has to test the immediate surrounding connected culture, society, people, and history of the place and location that we are studying. Yes. We go to the next one, please.
Thanks a lot,
sir. I hope I have answered.
Okay. Can we have the next person? So meanwhile, how does intangible heritage plays a role in urban conservation? Does it have any part in that?
Yes, intangible, the very word meaning is, it is not physical, but connected. So though it is not tangible, it is connected. So whether it is culture itself, has many components. Obviously, when the activity, just now I quoted the example of Jharkhand, Devgar, it is a pilgrimage site. But what we did is around 1 kilometer away from the actual site, identity giving. Because it has intangible connection, one is doing away from that. Charminar, there is an informal market that happens near Charminar. So we gave, why what is the need for studying a market that happens only on Sunday for the purpose of restoring identity of Charminar area. Though it is happening for 4 hours during Sunday, 4 or 5 hours during Sunday, why are we intervening in that area? So, because there is a connection to intangible. It is not just only single activity. It has to be studied comprehensively. Though we may not get opportunities in terms of projects, we may not get opportunities because projects are time limited, time bound, and that single, as I gave you example of drainage repair, only that has to be handled. You can't keep defining so many things. But when the project was to be identified during the year 2000, they did a comprehensive approach. That is what I am trying to highlight. When it comes to urban system, it is required to be viewed in a comprehensive perspective. Then there is a connection with intangible, and we realize when we take up comprehensive work. I cannot hear voice.
Yeah. So can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah. And also, sir, in your Gandikota site, you have mentioned that ASI protection is the one of the issue. So what was the issue and how it was addressed?
Yes. Typically, in Gandikota or in any location, Archaeological Survey of India has this 100 meter, 200 meter rule. There are about, because the Gandikota itself is not addressed and viewed as a overall area, so there are about 20 buildings, 20 monuments. So 20 monuments are required to be defined as 100 meter, 200 meter diameters. So when you say 100 meter, 200 meter around 20 buildings, we have the entire fort, entire overlapping. So now they wanted to do something within the fortified campus. They identified some land for tourism development. So now that was rejected, and they proposed it 1 kilometer away from the site. So how did we decide the location of it? Though there was a force, they already identified, they procured the land, we rejected. So the deciding based on the analysis within the site, one has to, so identifying a future sites for any project will depend on the understanding and availability of, though the 100 meter, 200 meter is a very blind rule they follow, that may not give any, define any character, because 100 meter, are we getting some character out of the context? 200 meter, no. When we say Charminar, there is Charkaman, it has to be up to Gulzar House. So we are talking about, it is visible from the Gulzar House, it is visible from Patargatti. So then we are talking about character. Then in the case of Gandikota, such kind of references were not possible. So with 100 meter, 200 meter itself, we decided the location for future project of tourism infrastructure. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Participant, does anyone has any other doubts? Okay. So I request all the participants to switch on your camera to take a virtual photography. Yes. So, thank you so much, sir. And we will be continuing our session after a short break. So, we will meet after 10 minutes. Like, we will get back by 3 p.m. sharp.
Yes.
Okay, I request everyone to join in using your same link. So we will resume our session by 3 p.m.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank Professor you, sir.
Professor Jabrin Nisa and Professor
Sir.
Everyone, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Break
sir 3 p.m.